good Saturday morning, everyone. Hope you're enjoying your Master Gardener program so far this morning. We are here for the third week of four programs from Iowa State University's campus, and a cold, frosty morning in Ames. Kind of a nice day again to be talking this time about vegetable gardening. We're going to hold it in the studio for an extra minute or two to make sure everyone is on the proper channel. We hope you are. Apparently there was a little confusion this morning about where you should be, but we hope that everybody finds us and we can enjoy the next couple of hours here with our Master Gardener program this morning. And with us in the studio this morning, the founder of Iowa State University's Master Gardener program and the coordinator, Linda Nave. Linda, this ought to be a good couple of hours. I think we have some good things going on.
I think it should be fun, Roger. We have a lot to talk about. We'll be covering things that they probably have done before in their gardens but never really gave much thought to it. As far as the founder of the program, I wouldn't quite go so far as to pat myself on the back to say I'm the founder. Our program did start here in Iowa in 1979 in Davenport. The county extension director there did a project while working on his master's degree in starting up a Master Gardener program, and we graduated 17 Master Gardeners at that time. Since then, the program has grown, and we are now teaching Master Gardener classes in 12 sites this year and recertifying in 8. So we've got Master Gardeners in about 56 counties in Iowa.
Okay, and this is we've had Master Gardener programs in Iowa every year since 1979?
That's right. So next year will be our decade of Master Gardeners.
Our 10th anniversary.
That's right.
The entire program nationwide precedes Iowa's involvement by some 7 years, I think.
That's right. The first Master Gardener program in the nation was started in Washington State in 1972. That program started under the need for more help from the county offices with the high demand for horticulture information. From there, many other states, like Iowa, picked up on the idea, modified it slightly to fit our needs, but it's basically the core program. Last year, we held our first National Master Gardener Conference, and we had representatives there from 42 states. So it was a very fun program in Washington, D.C. In 1989, it'll be the next National Master Gardener Conference, and it'll be held out in Oregon. So I think we have a lot of excitement coming up nationally for the program, and we are starting to unify nationally, coming up with a National Master Gardener Association. Matter of fact, all of those that attended the National Master Gardener Conference in Washington, D.C. are charter members of the National Master Gardener Program.
Fantastic. I really feel part of this because this is my second year to be hosting the From Iowa State part of our Master Gardener training. And you and I have done a number of television programs and radio programs about the entire program over the last couple of years. So I'm not yet a Master Gardener. One of these days I'm going to have to go through the series and become a Master Gardener.
Roger, I don't think you'd have any problem after you've been through all these uplinks and all the tapes that we've had. I think it shouldn't be a problem for you.
What are we going to talk about today? This is really on vegetable gardening, isn't it?
That's right. Up to now, they've probably learned all about the mulching, the fertilization, all the activities involved in gardening. Now what we're going to concentrate on today is the individual vegetable crops. Rather than talk about things that they should be doing in the garden, we'll talk about how these vegetables grow, how they should be harvested, why they should be harvested at certain times, and a little bit about their family background.
Okay. Before we start, real quick, I'd like to have our director, Dave Fincham, put that number down here so that we can tell you where to call. And there it is, 1-800-255-2255, extension 1409. We have two folks answering phones this morning, and we may even get in and answer one while the taped part of our program is on. We are live, and we are here to answer your questions, and we will be talking about this first taped segment right after and answering questions for 10 minutes or so. I guess it would be a good time to just go ahead and start and let folks, first of all, learn some things about tomatoes.
There are many different types of crops grown in home gardens. They belong to several plant families and have a wide range of growing requirements. In today's discussion, we are going to group the crops by plant families and those requiring similar growing conditions. Some of the most popular garden crops belong to the plant family, the Solanaceae family. It includes tomatoes, peppers, eggplants, and potatoes. The tomato is the most popular home garden crop due to its versatility and variations in size and color. They range from the standard round red fruit to the cherry cocktail type to pear shape. They are red, pink, orange, yellow, and white, all grown for different uses. Most home garden tomatoes are grown for fresh eating and canning. There are several good main season varieties available for this purpose. This variety is Jetstar. It is an excellent main season variety that produces good yields of high quality fruit. It's a hybrid resistant to verticillium and fusarium wilts. Some of the other tomato varieties recommended for Iowa are listed here and on PM607 suggested vegetable varieties. The pear shape or paste tomatoes are grown primarily for processing into sauces, pastes, and ketchup. They are very meaty and readily cooked down. However, they are not very juicy and so do not make very good fresh eating slicing type tomato. Not only do tomato plants produce a wide range of fruit types, they also vary in the way the fruit is produced on the plant. The cultural practices we use, such as staking or caging, should be based on how the plant grows and produces fruit. Basically, there are two ways tomato plants grow and flower. Tomato plants are considered determinate or indeterminate. The determinate tomato plant sets fruit in clusters on the stem, and the stem terminates in a flower cluster, as seen in this diagram. The fruit on a determinate plant ripens nearly the same time. This condenses the harvest period. This type of plant is advantageous to large-scale commercial growers. Some of the varieties that have a determinate growth habit are listed here. Generally, determinate tomato plants do not grow as tall as indeterminate types. They can be supported in cages, however, it is not recommended to stake and prune them because it may significantly reduce the yield. Indeterminate tomato plants, on the other hand, will grow and continue producing throughout the season if the conditions are favorable. The terminal bud of an indeterminate tomato plant does not set fruit. It always produces leaves and more stems from the growing point. These plants tend to grow quite tall and should be supported. With a few exceptions, most of the main season varieties have an indeterminate growth habit or some variation of it. This indeterminate variety is Sweet 100, which produces cherry tomatoes. Note the blossoms and fruits develop progressively on the plant, so fruit is in all stages of development and are on the vine at one time, and harvest may last for several months. Tomato flowers are self-fruitful, meaning they will set fruit with their own pollen. Cross-pollination is not required. However, tomato flowers are rather particular when it comes to setting fruit. High summer temperatures can affect the number of fruit produced in a couple of ways. High day-night temperatures will reduce flower production. The key is night temperature. If the night temperatures are above 70 degrees Fahrenheit, flower production is less and pollination is reduced. High temperatures, particularly for several consecutive days, coupled with drought conditions, will lead to lack of pollination and blossom drop. The most favorable night range for fruit set is between 58 and 68 degrees. The use of blossom set hormones does not give consistent results, so we do not recommend them as a means to increase yields. Other conditions, such as dry soil, shading, and excessive nitrogen can also reduce or prevent fruit set in tomatoes. Some tomato varieties, particularly the yellow, orange, and white colored fruit, have been advertised as low in acid or high in pH. This created questions as to whether these varieties were safe to can at home. The fear was that these varieties contain insufficient acid to prevent the growth of Clostridium botulinum, a food poisoning organism. As a result of this controversy, in 1975, the USDA did a study of 356 varieties to determine their pH range. They found that the varieties advertised as low in acid were actually quite high in acidity and not higher in pH than most of the standard varieties. Thus, there really was no such thing as a low acid tomato. This fruit may taste lower in acid than other types, though. This is because it has a higher sugar content that masks the acidity of the fruit. It should be noted, however, that the pH of all varieties vary with the growing conditions and maturity at harvest. certain precautions should still be taken when canning tomatoes, such as the canning quality, not overripe fruit, and adding citric acid or lemon juice to the tomatoes to ensure a low pH. In late July to mid-August, do you often have large numbers of yellow, orange-colored tomatoes set on the plants rather than the deep red fruit? If so, it is probably caused by a variety-temperature interaction. If the temperature stays near 100 degrees for any length of time, the mature green fruit will fail to fully ripen. The pigment responsible for the red color does not develop at temperatures much above 93 degrees. The optimum temperature range for color development is 68 to 70 degrees. This also means you should not attempt to ripen tomatoes in the refrigerator because they will not develop the characteristic red color. Blossom end rot on tomatoes is a common problem associated with inconsistent watering. This is a physiological disorder and not a disease that appears as a leathery scar or rot on the blossom end of fruits. It is caused by a calcium deficiency in the fruit, even though the stem and leaves have ample calcium. This does not mean more calcium is needed to be applied to the soil. It simply means it is important to maintain a steady rate of plant growth without stress from fluctuating moisture levels. Incidents of blossom end rot can be reduced by mulching and timely waterings. Generally, staked and heavily pruned plants are more prone to blossom end rot, particularly in dry years. Another fruit blemish is sunscald. It is the result of poor foliage cover. This may occur on fruits from plants that have been heavily pruned or have lost foliage due to diseases. Fruit cracking is a common problem that will vary in occurrence and severity between varieties. Like blossom end rot, cracking is associated with water stress within the plant. The cracks become most noticeable as the fruit approaches maturity. Some varieties tend to crack more readily than others. Varieties such as Jetstar and Supersonic seem to have some crack resistance. At first glance, you may think this tomato plant is suffering the effects of a wilt disease. It just had the misfortune of being planted too close to a black walnut tree. Tomatoes, as well as other plants in the Solanaceae family, should not be grown in close proximity to a black walnut tree because of a toxin found in the roots of these trees. This toxin will prevent the plant from fully utilizing the energy the leaves have captured. The toxin, known as juglone, is released from walnut trees into the environment in several ways, through root leakage, leaves falling, and nut husks. It does not move far in the soil, but only a minute amount is required to poison some plants. Tomato roots will encounter juglone when they grow within half to a quarter inch of the black walnut roots. It is recommended that tomatoes and other sensitive plants be grown at least 50 feet away from black walnut trees. It has also been suggested that the leaves, bark, or wood chips of black walnut not be used as a mulch around sensitive plants. Tomatoes and other crops can be injured by drift of herbicides, particularly 2,4-D, a common broadleaf weed herbicide used on lawns. The symptoms are curled, thick, distorted leaves. Injury from herbicide drift can be severe enough to reduce yields and distort fruits. In most cases, however, plants injured by 2,4-D drift will grow out of the damage. Although tomatoes are the most popular vegetable grown in home gardens, they are not without their share of disease problems. Two of the most common diseases of tomatoes are the fungal foliage diseases, Septoria and early blight. Initial symptoms of Septoria blight are small, purple to black spots on the foliage. As the spots age, the centers turn a light brown to tan in color. Heavily spotted leaves turn yellow and die. Early blight also begins as small, dark spots on the foliage. As early blight lesions age, they increase in size and develop a target pattern formed by concentric circles of light and dark brown. Several lesions may grow together, killing large portions of the leaves. Affected leaves turn yellow and die. Both Septoria blight and early blight usually occur on the lower portion of the plant first and move up through the plant. Frequently, both diseases may be found on the same plant. Since both diseases can cause severe defoliation, fruit is exposed to the sun and more prone to sunscald. Septoria blight and early blight can be controlled, but preventive measures are very important. Once plants are severely infected, it is difficult to save them. Such cultural practices as proper spacing of the plants, staking or caging plants for better air circulation around the individual plants, watering at the soil surface so foliage does not get wet, and maintaining a balanced fertility program will help prevent these two foliage diseases. Since the fungi which cause these diseases can survive in infested plant debris in the garden, good sanitation is very important. All infected plant debris should be removed from the garden and destroyed. Finally, there are a number of fungicides which are labeled for use in controlling septoria blight and early blight. Before using a fungicide, be certain that it is labeled for use on tomatoes, then follow the label directions and get good coverage on the plants. Another broad category of tomato diseases are the vascular wilt diseases. Verticillium wilt and fusarium wilt are vascular wilt diseases caused by fungi which grow in the vascular or water-conducting tissue of the plant. Typically, infected plants will wilt during the day and recover at night until they reach a permanent wilting point. Wilted portions of the plant yellow and die. Vascular wilt diseases do not produce any spots on the foliage. One symptom which can be used to diagnose a vascular wilt disease is a brown discoloration of the vascular tissues. Break off a lower wilted branch or the main stem. Peel away the outer epidermis and look for brown discoloration. In healthy stems, such as the lower one here, the vascular tissue just beneath the outer epidermis will be white or cream colored. In a diseased stem, such as the upper one, the vascular tissue will be brown. The vascular wilt diseases are more difficult to control. The fungi which cause these diseases can survive in the soil for a number of years. Crop rotation is very important. Planting resistant varieties may also help. A V or F after the tomato variety name means that variety has resistance to verticillium and fusarium wilts. Although resistant varieties may still become infected, they are usually less severely affected and will yield better than susceptible varieties. Besides foliage diseases, fruit rots can also be a problem on tomatoes. One of the common fruit rots of tomatoes is the fungal fruit rot anthracnose. At first, anthracnose appears as small, water-soaked spots on the fruit. The spots enlarge quite rapidly and may turn darker in color. Anthracnose may occur on tomatoes on the vine or harvested fruit. Fungicide sprays, such as those recommended for septoria or early blight, will help control anthracnose. Also, pick fruit as it ripens. Do not let overripe fruit remain on the vine. There are very few insect pests that are constant problems on tomatoes, although there are a couple that are occasional problems for home gardeners. Cutworms are one such pest. They do not exclusively attack tomatoes, but will damage many crops in the garden. They are basically two types of cutworms found in the garden, surface cutworms and climbing cutworms. Surface cutworms, like the black cutworm, feed on the plant right at the soil surface, causing them to wilt or break off. A mechanical control that can prevent cutworm damage to seedlings is the use of a collar, usually made of stiff paper, placed around seedling or transplants. If you have a half-acre patch, this is not very practical, but when you have only three tomato plants, that's a pretty cheap protection. A word of advice though, the cutworm collars work very well, assuming that when you put the collar around the plant, the cutworm is on the outside and not the inside of the collar. Climbing cutworms will climb plants to feed on the foliage or fruits. The most common climbing cutworm is called the variegated cutworm. This pest is recognized by the row of white or yellow dots down the middle of the back. The variegated cutworms feed on many vegetable crops and flowers. Cutworms are usually nocturnal. They do their feeding at night. They are inactive during the day and hide under mulch, leaf litter, and clods of dirt. This habit explains the frequent complaint gardeners have of not being able to find the cause of the damage in the garden. It also reminds us that pest monitoring can be more than just looking at leaves. You must have to get down and move the mulch or clods of dirt to find the pest. If the cutworms can be found, hand picking is probably the best control for home gardens. Several insecticides can be applied to the soil for cutworm protection in situations of heavy infestation or over large areas. Pelleted insecticide baits is a good cutworm control because of its selectivity. Unfortunately, however, the pelleted cutworm baits are usually not readily available in small packages. Although they are not a common problem, tomato hornworms attract a lot of attention from gardeners simply by their size and the amount of defoliation only a few of these caterpillars can do. They will feed on tomatoes, peppers, and other crops in the same plant family. Hornworms are easily identified by the pointed projection at the end of the body that looks like a horn. These caterpillars will grow to be 3 to 4 inches in length and consume a lot of foliage. The adult is a sphinx moth, sometimes called a hawk or hummingbird moth. They are seen in early summer hovering over petunias, and there is only one generation a year. Generally, picking off the caterpillars by hand is often sufficient control in a small garden because there probably will only be a few, and they are quite easily to spot. Insecticides such as 7 or BT can be used if it is necessary to spray. Do not destroy caterpillars that are covered by large white oval bumps. These caterpillars were parasitized by a beneficial wasp and will soon die naturally. The wasps will emerge to parasitize other caterpillars. Being members of the same plant family, peppers require many of the same growing conditions as tomatoes, such as moderate night temperatures for fruit set. There are several different types of peppers available, and most will grow fairly well in the Midwest. The sweet peppers include the favorite bell or green pepper, the sweet banana, small red cherry, sweet pickle, and the yellow varieties, such as gypsy hybrid. One of the popular hot varieties is the green-fruited jalapeno. Eggplant is a member of the Solanaceae family, but it is not widely grown as tomatoes and peppers. They, too, grow in various sizes and shapes. One of the pest problems on eggplant is the small black flea beetle. It chews small holes in the leaves. A large population of flea beetles will cause eggplant leaves to look as though they were blasted by a shotgun. Flea beetles can be controlled with common garden insecticides such as 7 or malathion. The next crop we are going to discuss, the potato, is also a member of the Solanaceae family. But unlike tomatoes and peppers, though, the fruit is not the edible portion. Potatoes have always been a popular home garden crop because of their storage qualities. The potato tuber is formed on the tips of stolons, which are actually underground stems. Thus, the potato tuber is actually stem tissue, with the eyes being the buds. The first tubers are formed at the tips of the stolons, closest to the seed piece. Later, tubers are formed on stolons that develop further up the stem. By mounding around the plants as they grow, the yields can be increased slightly. This also reduces the risk of tuber exposure, which results in green tissue. This green portion contains the compound solanin, which can be poisonous if it's consumed in large quantities. If green tissue does develop on the potato tuber, this portion should be removed before the potato is eaten.
And we are back in the studio to answer your questions. If you would, give us a call. You have a few minutes here before our next pre-taped piece. Again, the number is 1-800-255-2255, extension 1409. And we hope everyone is on site today on the bird. And we know that you are, if you're able to see us. And we have some questions to answer. Let's begin with a question on cucumbers. Someone has called and said they've tried to raise cucumbers on a livestock trellis. Is that, and it isn't working very well, is that too hot? Is it too tall?
Well, Well, the problem with the livestock trellis is not the problem probably because it's too hot.
Mm-hmm.
I have never heard anybody say that their cucumbers have burned up because it's too hot.
Mm-hmm.
It's probably other factors involved. It could be drought stress. It could be bacterial wilt. It could be insect feeding. I doubt it's the cattle panel that's doing the problem. It's logical that it could get heated up, but I really don't think that's the problem. Personally, I've used them, and I haven't had any problem with it. They work very well, as a matter of fact. Many gardeners write to me and say they've discovered the cattle panel as a good trellis for tomatoes, as a good trellis for cucumbers, squash, and other things. As far as how tall, well, you ever heard of Jack and the Beanstalk? It really doesn't matter how tall these things have to be. A minimum height, I would say, for a good trellis would be 3 feet,
mm-hmm.
because the cucumber, most varieties, except for the bush varieties, will exceed that by about another 3 feet. So I would go at least 3 to 4
yeah.
feet tall. The height really is more of a minimum rather than a too tall.
Linda, I know that heat does affect some of our crops in the summertime. For instance, hot nights with tomatoes, we like to keep things cool down a little bit. They don't grow quite so well when we have these constant over, 75 degree temperatures.
That's right. We have a lot of vegetables that really have a problem with high temperatures. Tomatoes, as we discussed, and peppers with their blossoms, they'll drop the blossoms mm-hmm. under high night temperatures. Another problem we have is also with high temperatures on onions, and we'll talk about that a little later. High temperatures on some of our beans may cause either not fruit set, or with some of the lima beans, it might even encourage production. Lima
mm-hmm.
beans require hot temperatures.
Okay. Let's talk about the acidity of the soil. Someone asks about if they have over 8 pH soil, what do they have to do to grow a garden? Grow vegetables?
Move their garden. The problem with pH soils depends, or to modify the problem, depends on your soil type. If you have a sandy loam or a very tight soil, the ranges of elemental sulfur that you'll need will vary considerably. A good garden grows at pH 6.5 to 6.8. That's optimum. A garden will grow at 7.5, but at 8 we're running into a lot of problems because at these high pH soils, you've probably learned in your soil lesson, that many of our nutrients, essential plant nutrients, are not available to some of our plants. And so we see limited growth, we see poor production. As far as improving it, it can be improved, although it may take some time. You can apply elemental sulfur at specific rates. You might want to have your soil tested, and from there they will give you the recommendation for your soil, specific soil type. Soil test at Iowa State University, that is. There's other things you can use, organic materials such as peat moss, even pine needles worked into the soil. If you have a lot of that, over time it will bring
mm-hmm.
it down. But peat moss is something that works fairly well at bringing the pH down, but it does take some time.
Okay. Bring me up to speed, if you will, on the lesson on soil testing. Have the folks been through that?
Many of the counties out in the
mm-hmm.
state have had their soil unit. They're probably pretty well baffled. That is a difficult
mm-hmm.
unit to understand because there's some chemistry involved. But when it comes to soil pH, it is very critical because of the nutrients involved. You could have all the iron or all the other nutrients readily in the soil, but at high pH, some of them just are not taken up or available for the plants.
A soil test is really a very easy thing to do, and it's really quite inexpensive. If you go through your county extension office, it works very well.
That's right. The cost of the soil test is $550.
Mm-hmm.
It's a computerized program that they'll send back to you with your soil pH,
mm-hmm.
your available phosphorus and potassium for the plants that's in the soil, and they'll give a recommendation as to the amounts of these nutrients or how to modify the pH,
okay.
how to modify your soil to balance the pH.
Okay, so it's something that you can counsel folks on as master gardeners. A good soil test is really worth it,
mm-hmm.
I think, for good gardening. Dick Thuma calls this morning and asks about a square foot vegetable gardening. I'm not sure what he means by that. The advantages and disadvantages. You do.
Yeah, it's a technique that many gardeners are incorporating if they have a small space. It, as far as do I recommend it, that's questionable. If you have a small garden, it probably is beneficial because you're working intensively, you're planting a number of crops in a very limited area.
Mm-hmm.
What you do is you take your garden size and you block it off into square yards, then square feet, and then from there you plant within that square. Perhaps if you're planting beets, you would scatter sow the seeds in that particular square and then thin it out. It's again good for small gardens. However, for larger gardens, it's not practical because it's very labor intensive.
Okay. Dick also asks about lima beans. He says his lima beans are too bushy. They get a good bloom and no bean set. Why?
Lima beans are really not a crop for Iowa.
Really?
They require a little bit longer growing season than bush beans. Mm-hmm. Well, quite a bit longer, as a matter of fact. And they require very high temperatures. Although we do get that in Iowa, they like the consistent temperatures and the warm nights. One of the better ones is the baby Ford hook. Perhaps it's the variety that the person planted that's having this problem. You might want to stick with some of the bush beans rather than the longer growing ones, and the baby lima beans.
Okay. Jim Miller is watching in Clinton. Says every year his green peppers grow but don't bloom till late in the season. Why is that?
It could be the location in which he's growing it. It just may be extremely hot in that particular mm-hmm. site. High nighttime temperatures, or else early in the season it could be low temperatures. I would change the location slightly as to where those peppers are growing, grow some of the recommended varieties, and basically give it as much cultural care as possible.
Okay, if you're starting your garden from transplants and you're mm-hmm. doing peppers, when do you want to get them in? Could that be a problem, maybe getting them in a little bit too late?
Perhaps. Generally, though, we want to plant our peppers about the same time we direct plant our tomato plants mm-hmm. out without a covering. It would be
Memorial Day?
Well, at the latest.
Yeah.
In Clinton, for example, where Jimmy Miller's county is, he'd probably want to get them in May 15th.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Question from Scott County. Does storing apples and potatoes together cause the potatoes to root? That's an interesting thought.
To root?
Yeah.
That's interesting. I've never seen that or heard that, mm-hmm. but I wouldn't be surprised because the apple, as you learn in your fruit lesson in a couple of weeks, is a breathing organism. It respires and it gives off ethylene gas. Ethylene is the ripening hormone, mm-hmm. and it has effect on other plant materials. And as far as tubers, it probably will encourage it to grow, that tuber. So I wouldn't be surprised. Yes, they're probably detrimental to the potatoes, and you shouldn't really store fruits and vegetables in the same general area for that reason.
We'll get Dick Gladden over here one of these days to answer questions like that, because he's one of the scientists and researchers in horticulture.
That's right. Another reason you wouldn't want to store apples and potatoes is that they require different storage temperatures. Most apples like a storage temperature just above freezing, 32 to 36 degrees. Whereas potatoes, if you store them at that temperature, you're going to run into a starch to sugar conversion, and you won't have real good quality potatoes. So you're better off storing them in separate areas for that reason, too.
Okay. Question about the toxicity of walnut trees. How long does it take the toxic substance in the soil from walnut trees to go away after the trees have been cut down?
Well, many people feel that if they cut down their little walnut seedlings or the walnut tree that they don't like in their yard, they're going to have instant success with their tomatoes. Well, that's not necessarily the case because that toxin may linger in the root system till it's totally decomposed, and that may be 7 years depending on the size of the original tree. So it's not an instant relief if you chop that tree down. What you might want to do is in that tilled area near where the walnut tree was, you may want to just go ahead and plant things that aren't real susceptible to walnut injury. And then after a few years of tilling and leaching of the soil, probably mm-hmm. the toxin is leached out thoroughly.
Okay. When spraying tomatoes, how long do you have to wait after applying insecticides and fungicides before you harvest?
Well, that's a really good question because it varies. We can't give you a 3-day or 2-day comment on that. What you need to do is check the label. Generally speaking, most fungicides have a 0 or just a few day waiting period, where insecticides may be longer. It's very important when using these products that you check the label before you spray. So if your crop is coming close to harvest and you can't wait 4 days or 7 days, don't spray at that time.
Okay. We appreciate the questions, and we hope you have lots more of them. We'll have plenty of time after our next tape segment to answer some more. And again, the number to call is 1-800-255-2255, extension 1409. That's a national number. Give us a call if you're from out of state. As I remember, a couple of weeks ago, we had calls from Montana. So if you're just happening to catch the program today on your own satellite dish, and you have a gardening question, give us a call. I think our master gardeners would appreciate your input also. We'll go back now to the garden and find out about some more of our vegetable crops.
The next group of plants we're going to discuss belong to the plant family Liliaceae. Onions, leeks, shallots, and chives are all relatives of our common Easter lily. Although we often consider onions a root crop, the onion bulb is actually swollen leaf tissue. In order for a bulb to develop, the growing season for onions must first be cool, followed by long days and high temperatures. A question often asked regarding onions is whether it is best to plant them as sets, transplants, or seeds. To answer this question, a small study was set out in which the same variety of onion was planted as sets, transplants, and direct seeded. In this study, all of the treatments were planted at the same time. The seeded onions were thinned to the same plant spacing as the others. By the end of July, this is how they looked. The tops of the onions from the transplants and sets were beginning to fall over, and the bulbs were nearly full-sized. These bulbs are harvested 3 weeks later. The seeded onions, on the other hand, were still growing vigorously, and the bulbs are just beginning to enlarge. The yield results showed very little difference between the three planting methods. However, the seeded plants were harvested nearly 20 days later. Since the onions started from sets and transplants were harvested earlier, they were in storage for 20 days before the seeded onions were harvested. Thus, of course, they probably did not keep as long into the winter months as did the onions started from seed. Also, it has been found that onions started from seed into the garden are less likely to sprout in storage than those started from sets and transplants. If you do use sets, it is a good idea to sort them before planting. Plant the larger sets for use as green onions and plant the smaller sets to be grown for mature onions to be stored. A relative of the onions is the shallot. Shallots are similar to garlic except the cloves are not enclosed by a sheath and they have milder flavor. Shallots are planted early in the season as sets. They can be harvested immature and eaten like a scallion onion. Leeks are the last crop we are going to discuss in this plant family. Leeks are not a difficult crop to grow. They should be started indoors as transplants about 8 to 10 weeks before planting them in the garden. The culture of leeks is similar to onions, except they should be planted about 4 to 6 inches apart and blanched as they grow to produce the long white base. This is done by mounding soil up around them. Leeks are harvested when the stem is quite thick and succulent. The tops remain green and do not die down at maturity like onions. The cucurbit family is the next group to be covered. It includes many of the popular garden crops, cucumbers, melons, squash, and pumpkins. The cucurbits have a different flowering habit than most garden crops. They are referred to as monoecious. This means there are both male and female flowers on the same plant. The female flower is distinguished by the small fruit just beneath the petals. This is a male watermelon flower, and this is the female flower. Note it has the small melon under the yellow petals. After pollination, this small fruit, actually the ovary of the flower, begins to enlarge. In order for fruit to set, both male and female flowers need to be present and receptive. Generally, squash and most cucumbers will produce a number of male flowers before a female flower appears on the vine. Thus, the first flowers on the plant usually do not set fruit. Cross-pollination among cucurbits has been a concern for many home gardeners and has been misunderstood for a long time. Most cucurbits will not cross-pollinate. For example, a squash will not cross-pollinate with a watermelon because they are not close enough relatives. In other words, they do not belong to the same species. Only crops, such as some squashes of the same species, will cross-pollinate. If cross-pollination between two squash varieties does occur, it will not show up in the current season's fruit. However, if the seeds are saved and planted, the cross may be evident in that generation. What this boils down to is that cucumbers, melons, and squash can be planted in close proximity without cross-pollination occurring. In the past, cucurbits have been off-limits for small gardens because of the large amount of growing room they require. However, within recent years, many varieties have been developed that require much less space. They are sometimes referred to as bush varieties. The bush-type varieties usually do not yield as many fruit per vine, and the fruit tends to be smaller than the vining types. However, the quality is quite good. Another recent development in cucurbits is the breeding of all-female cucumber plants. An all-female plant is called gynoecious. This means that the plant produces nearly all female flowers. Gynoecious varieties are desirable because they tend to produce an earlier and greater yields. Sometimes the pollen source is provided by a few seeds of another variety, which are included in the seed packages. With some varieties, the fruit will set without pollination, resulting in seedless fruit. Bitter-flavored cucumbers is a common problem in many home gardens. This bitterness is associated with many things. It generally occurs in fruits on unhealthy plants late in the season. This bitterness compound develops in high concentrations during hot, dry weather and is usually concentrated at the stem end of the fruit. It can also be present in and just under the cucumber skin. The incidence of bitterness can be reduced by maintaining healthy plants throughout the growing season and by planting varieties that are less prone to bitterness. Also, peeling the fruit and removing a greater portion of the stem may reduce the bitterness flavor. Muskmelon picked from the garden or purchased from the farmer's market may have an off flavor. Also, they may appear perfect but lack the characteristic sweetness. This poor flavor can be caused by several factors. Generally, cool temperatures during fruit development will result in a bland flavor. Inadequate fertilization has also been associated with poor flavor in muskmelons. Harvesting the melons before they are ripe will result in a poorly flavored fruit because much of the sugar moves into the fruits just prior to maturity. Poorly adapted varieties and wet, cloudy weather during fruit maturity are also blamed for poor fruit quality. Summer and winter squash are classified according to the times that they are harvested. Summer squash are harvested immature before the seeds develop and while the skin is still soft. These fruits do not store for long periods of time. As most gardeners know, and beginning gardeners soon discover, summer squash can be very productive. Only a few plants will keep a family well supplied throughout the summer. Winter squash, on the other hand, are harvested mature when the skin is firm. Under proper storage conditions, they will keep for 2 to 5 months. This is an unusual cucurbit. It is the loofah gourd. Although the immature fruit can be eaten, it is grown primarily for its use as a sponge after it is processed. It is strictly a novelty item in which the fruit is later used as a sponge. To make a sponge from the loofah gourd, the mature gourds are boiled or baked whole to loosen the skin. After the skin is peeled off, the pulp and seeds are removed by rubbing two fruits together. This leaves the cellulose skeleton that will be the sponge. The cucurbits are not free of pest problems. There are a few insects and diseases that can be damaging year after year. The spotted and striped cucumber beetles are frequently seen in the garden on cucumbers and related plants. The spotted cucumber beetle is also known as the southern corn rootworm beetle. These beetles feed on the foliage, blossoms, and sometimes the fruit of cucurbits. However, the most serious problem associated with the cucumber beetles is a plant disease known as bacterial wilt. Both species of cucumber beetles are vectors or carriers of the bacterium that causes wilt disease in melons and cucumbers. Both the striped and spotted cucumber beetles spend the winter in the adult stage, harboring the bacterium in their bodies. When the cucumber beetles resume activity in the spring, they search for cucumber or melon plants to feed on. Their feeding introduces bacteria into the plant early in the spring. but you do not know that the plant is sick until midsummer, when the vines start to run. Generally, one runner or a portion of the vine wilts first on an infected plant. Then the entire plant wilts and dies. By the time the plant shows symptoms of wilting, there is nothing you can do. You can rogue out the infected plants, but they cannot be cured. We estimate it takes a minimum of 3 weeks between the time the bacteria is introduced until you see wilting symptoms. It can, however, be considerably longer than that. It can be half the summer that the plant is sick and you do not know it. The only prevention we have for bacteria wilt is the control of cucumber beetles. And right now, the only proven control for cucumber beetles is chemical insecticide application. You may be able to cover your cucumber seedlings for a while with cheesecloth or a floating row cover to keep the beetles off, but this isn't always effective or practical. Companion plantings with other crops or herbs have not proven effective in controlling the beetles. Another pest found on cucurbits is the squash bug. They spend the winter as adults hidden in sheltered locations. They typically begin laying eggs on the squash plant about the times the vines begin to run. The brick red eggs appear in clusters, usually on the undersides of leaves in the angles formed by the veins. When the eggs hatch, tiny green nymphs emerge and begin feeding on the sap from the leaves. Larger nymphs turn characteristic gray color and continue feeding gregariously. The nymphs have a disagreeable odor when smashed and are inappropriately called stink bugs by some gardeners. Badly infested leaves will wilt rapidly and later will become blackened and crisp. The nymphs frequently migrate to the fruit in late summer or fall. Hand-picking adults or egg masses is recommended for small plantings. Removing infested leaves may also be a way to eliminate part of the population. Insecticide sprays labeled for squash bug control are most effective against the small nymphs and are not extremely effective against the adults. The last insect pest of the cucurbits we are going to talk about is the squash vine borer. This caterpillar bores in the base of the squash plant. Borer infestation may cause a plant to wilt when the plant is under stress. Activity of the borers is detected by the presence of a moist frass on the outside of infected stems. If you see an infected plant early, before too much damage has been done, corrective surgery might help. Split the stem open, dig out the larvae, and throw them away. Close the plant back up and cover the incision with moist soil. The vine may root at the buried nodes and resume growth. The squash vine borer adult is a moth, but it flies during the day. It looks like a wasp and hovers over the plants. The females lay their eggs at the base of the plants beginning in mid-June. If you see the moth active in the garden, then would be the time to spray the base of the plants with a residual insecticide. Otherwise, weekly sprayings are advised from about mid-June to mid-July in areas where squash vine borers have been a problem.
And we are back, and welcome, and we're getting lots and lots of good questions, so we're going to get right to it. Remember, the phone number, 1-800-255-2255, extension 1409. I don't think we need to tell that too many more times because we've got a tremendous number of questions, but keep calling. We are here to answer your questions. First question, what are the advantages of different potato planting methods? The straw method, tires, traditional. Does that make sense?
Yes, that makes sense. We'll just discuss each of these. The straw method is where you plant the seed piece on top of the soil and cover it with straw, several inches of straw. Or you can dig a trench about 6 inches deep, put the potato seed piece or tuber eye on the bottom of the trench, and then fill in the trench with straw. Either way, the objective is to produce clean tubers in which the potatoes that are grown come out and are produced from the stolons in that clean straw, making harvesting, theoretically, a little easier, and we have less incidence of scab infection. Does this work? We tried this at one of our demonstration gardens about 4 years ago. We dug a 6 to 8 inch trench, put the seed piece on the bottom, filled it with straw, and kept that straw at about 6 to 12 inches, slightly mounded. the straw decomposed somewhat, and it was very difficult to harvest the tubers. It was like harvesting it in a compost pile. The tubers generally tended to be smaller in size, and we didn't get any more of them. I think water is a real critical factor when it comes to growing it in straw. If you have access to water, a lot of water available, then you may have some success. The same principles apply with growing it in tires, and that is simply where you have one tire and you put the seed piece in, cover it with about 4 inches of soil. As the plant grows and comes out of that certain tire area, you put another tire on, add more soil, so just the tops of the plants are showing. It's the same effect as mounding. The gardeners that use it say they get increased yields, and you'll hear some people claim they get 200 pounds of tubers out of one plant with the tires over it. And you can keep stacking it up through the growing season. Once again, the problem with this is available moisture. If the soil dries out or becomes too compact, we're not going to get good tuber development. Also, that tire may serve to heat up that soil extremely hot, and we're not going to get good tuber development. It has to be just the right season to get yields like many people brag about in the tire method. I still say if you have a good soil, fairly low pH soil, fairly sandy, plant early, you're going to get good tubers the conventional way of planting in the soil.
Okay. Call from Creston. What determines the transplantability of plants? Why do some vegetables transplant better than others?
That question is a good one because plants vary with their root systems. For example, some plants produce a very dominant, strong taproot. Some examples of this is the cucurbits, the muskmelons, watermelons, cucumbers. Start with a very dominant taproot. Now, if that taproot is disrupted in any way, that reduces its transplantability, and they just don't start well. We've overcome this problem with some of our transplants with muskmelons and cucumbers, in which we grow them in peat pots, because then the roots will eventually grow through the pot, and we can set the pot and all in the ground without worrying about root injury. Tomatoes, you can practically prune their roots off and still get a good stand because they are more readily able to regenerate new roots. Peppers and tomatoes particularly, regenerate roots very rapidly from the stem. You can actually see these points on a bumpy young transplant stem near the base.
Okay, yeah. So it really depends on the viability of the roots or whether they're fragile or not. That
right,
sort of thing.
The type of roots they have. Sweet corn, some people say to transplant sweet corn. I've never heard of this until I started working with a preschool or nursery school group where they started some indoors and set them out, and they had fairly good luck. Generally, that is not a common practice, again, because of its root system. And it's the way the seed is attached to the plant because you can cause some injury there. So as the roots emerge from the seeds. So. There are certain plants, and it's primarily due to the way they form their roots and their initiates for the roots on the stems.
And with sweet corn, of course, we've got some early varieties that we can put in. So if you like to extend that season, you can do it that way.
Right. That'd be the only secret. That's what I was thinking about with sweet corn. Many times the sweet corn cannot be planted in cool soils because of poor germination, and people want to start them indoors and then set them out. So they get a little head start with this extra sweet type sweet corn. It doesn't really work very well.
Question about cauliflower. They have what they call, I think it's medium brown slime rot. Why does it occur? What can be done? What an awful sounding.
Well, that sounds real tasty, doesn't it? Medium brown slime rot. That's probably due to a high moisture level in and around the curds. Mm-hmm. Perhaps some water got in when they were overhead irrigating, got in around the plant and the curd or the head while it's been tied up. This may have attracted some of the disease-causing organisms. Perhaps there was dirt in there, too. I'm not a plant pathologist, so there could be several reasons for that, but I assume it's probably due to high moisture in and around that head. What can they do about it? Well, it's difficult to control, probably, once it's there. One of the better things to do is just don't allow a lot of overhead moisture. Of course, you can't do anything about the rain, but that'd be my major way to start.
Okay. The same person asked, this is from Creston again, asks about possible experiments done to blanch cauliflower with cloth. And we talked about that beforehand. You're not aware of?
I'm not aware of any studies that were done down in that area. With cauliflower, you can purchase two types, the self-blanching and the typical cauliflower. Self-blanching types have more erect, upright leaves that sort of cover the head, but under high temperatures, these leaves open up and expose the head to the sunshine, and we run into problems with browning and discoloration with the self-blanching, particularly in the heat of the summer, late June, early July, when they got them in just a little late and those leaves flap open. We've tried using brown paper bags or some darker cloth to cover the heads, and that seems to work very well, too. As a matter of fact, some commercial growers use that, or else they just take rubber bands and stick it over the the cauliflower, the upright leaves. Yep. As far as white cloth, I'm not familiar with that technique, and I don't know how well it would work. But it would block the sunshine. It would reflect the light, although it would let some through. A darker material might help.
Okay.
Perhaps not black, because that'll attract the heat, somewhere in between.
Okay. Each time we have one of these programs, we always get calls about where to go for recommendations, printed material, and so on. And someone wants to know if there are references for spacing different plants. We do have lots of material available in Extension.
Yes, and the Master Gardener materials that you should have received should have much of that information in it, particularly on planting. We have a publication called Planting a Home Vegetable Garden, and on the back of that publication is a table that lists this plant spacings. Now, this plant spacing list, we should have indicated on the table, but we did not. It's primarily for row-produced crops. For example, if you're growing nice straight rows of garden vegetables, this tells the plant spacing between the plants and between the rows. Now, if you're going wide row gardening or square foot gardening, these dimensions will change.
Okay. Question from Sioux City about indeterminate tomatoes. Why doesn't an indeterminate tomato prune to a single stalk and stake, why doesn't it suffer from sun scald?
It does.
It does.
Yeah. Anytime you're pruning a plant, what you're doing is you're limiting some of the canopy of the plant by reducing some of the branches, so to speak. So you are exposing that fruit to sun scald. Better than one stake would be two, allowing two stems, better than one stem, I should say, to tie to the stake, allow two. You get better foliage cover, and then if your plants are infected with some of our foliage diseases, you have less likelihood of severely sun scalding your fruit. You have more foliage there to work with. So actually a one-stem system is not the optimum. A two-stem would probably be best.
Question about adding manure for fertilizer. What happens if you add too much manure? What will happen?
Well, too much of anything is a bad thing.
Yeah.
What they might want to do is not apply too much, especially fresh manure, right out of the barnyard, because that can injure plants' roots. There are high soluble salts within that manure. When mixed into the soil, can cause some burning on the plant's roots, and you'll see limited growth. You may see some browning on the foliage, just reduced yields.
Okay. Question quick about using fruit set dust or spray. Is it useful in enhancing blossom set on greenhouse tomatoes? This is from Linn County.
I'm not real familiar with greenhouse production of tomatoes. However, I would say perhaps, perhaps not, depending on the factors. That blossom set will induce fruit development without seed development, what we call parthenocarpic development of the fruit, without pollination. We may get some deformed fruit this way. However, I would say the best way to generate fruit set in tomatoes, greenhouse tomatoes, is to agitate the blossom. Of course, we don't get the breezes in the greenhouse unless you brush against it. Many greenhouse producers will have some type of a little gadget that agitates the blossoms to get that pollen onto the female portion of the plant.
Okay, very good. We'll be back in another few minutes with some more of your questions. Give us a call. Right now, some more in the garden.
The coal crops are all members of the plant family Cruciferae. This includes cabbage, cauliflower, broccoli, kohlrabi, kale, and Brussels sprouts. Cabbage is a popular crop for home gardens. It is a biennial, although it is grown as an annual crop. There are a lot of variations between types of cabbage and varieties. They vary in size, shape, color, and the texture of the leaves and heads. The Savoy cabbage has crinkled, textured leaves. The quality of the Savoy head is considered superior.